Okay. Hello, everyone. Thanks a lot for joining this session. It's very helpful, and as it's time, let's start here. So in this session, we'll be basically discussing our experience and evaluations with technologies on Google Cloud to support high-speed and highly scalable REST API. Hopefully, most of our evaluations should be helpful for your further support and deployments elsewhere. About me, I am Pratik Srivastav. I am technical architect with Sigmoid. I have more than 13 years of experience in big data, cloud, and service-oriented architecture. And I have worked with various products and services to sustain various deployments across the world. I have been working with Sigmoid for a while now. My company, Sigmoid, is backed by Sequoia and has won several accolades and awards at various junctures. We are a 250-plus specialist team, and we provide data solutions in AI, big data, and data sciences. We have offices in New York, San Francisco, Lima, Dallas, and Bangalore. And many of our tech folks are based out of Bangalore. Nextly, coming down to the agenda, firstly, we'll be discussing the problem statement. Then we'll be discussing the technical requirements based on what we could identify based on our discussion with various stakeholders. And to simplify your understanding of it, in this session, we'll be taking up a small data flow diagram, show them how the message flows, and what were the tech stack considerations. After that, we'll be discussing various environment setups and evaluations that we took up. Lastly, we'll discuss about the cost evaluations and the conclusion, and based on all these evaluations, what was the proposed architecture we made. And as the time is short, we had to discard many of our results, hopefully, we'll be adding a blog in which we'll be adding all those content for you guys to refer. Okay. Next, coming down to the business use case. So one of our client in ad tech space wanted to create a real-time pre-bid analytics pipeline. Pre-bid is upcoming open source header bidding solution. Header bidding is a technology where where the publishers can host the auctions for ads in the web page itself. So, and analytics adapter of pre-bid will capture all the events related to those auction, the bids, the cost, etc., and send all those events to a backend REST API. And the ingested data from the REST API will be further flown into a data warehouse process, etc., so that it's displaying in the dashboard. And now this entire thing should happen in real time so that the stakeholders and other business users can take real time insights from the system. And a summary of business and technology constraints. As the technology was new and people wanted to quickly onboard, the solution cost should be low. It should be less than $30,000 per month. And the time to market was also very critical, and we had to deliver the solution within a month. And based on discussion with various stakeholders, we identified that almost 70 to 80,000 requests per second of concurrency we had to support in our REST API. That translates to roughly 1.1 GB data per second based on our experience with the payloads that we were receiving. And SLA to the dashboard should be 7 minutes. So this required that REST API should be able to write to the Google Cloud Storage within 3 to 4 minutes. Coming to the technical requirements, based on our discussions with various stakeholders, these are the technical requirements which we have. Mainly, the throughput should be very high. The REST API should support high level of concurrency and throughput. So roughly, that comes down to 300 Mbps to 770 Mbps. Solution should be cost effective. The cost of the solution should not be more than $30,000 per month. Scalability and load balancing, because we noticed that the incoming traffic would vary in almost sinusoidal format. So the REST API and the related services should be able to upscale and downscale very quickly so that the average cost over the day should be reduced drastically. Nextly, the solution should have fault tolerance so that there's a downtime in certain resources that should not impact the pipeline, and should also have higher availability. The REST API should be available so that all the data which is published to the REST API that is captured, as this data is monetarily critical to the company. And latency, 90% of messages should show up in the dashboards within 7 minutes. So like discussed previously, this means that within 3 to 4 minutes, once the message is published to the REST API, it should be saved into Google Cloud Storage. Delivery reliability, as the data warehouse solution which we are using, that is the NitroDB, that is Sigma's in-house offering, that supports deduplication to certain extent. Up to 10% of duplicates was acceptable in the ingestion layer. So at least once this delivery was good enough for us. And persistence and durability of payload should be supported. Longevity tests should be run so that we can identify that system stability is given. And monitoring and maintenance costs have to be tracked because of DD, so that the system uptime is high. Okay. This is the data flow diagram on top. The analytics adapter sits inside the user web page. So let's say that a user opens Seattle Times, various ads are shown. All the events led to the ads being shown are captured by the analytics adapter and published to the load and sent to the load balancer. Load balancer also distributes across the REST API layer. REST API layer then publishes to the streaming broker. And then we have a data transfer service, which is responsible for in micro batch periodically polling the streaming broker and getting all the messages that are present and writing it to Google Cloud Storage. And finally, as soon as the messages are returned to Google Cloud Storage, data warehouse is capable of listening to the incoming messages in the Google Cloud Storage and translating it into events and processing that data and showing it into that dashboard. Now the focus of this talk is about the streaming layer. So these are the available tech stacks in Google Cloud, which we could identify. Mainly the managed services provided by Google, Google PubSub, plus Google Dataflow. Google PubSub is a streaming broker and Google Dataflow is stream processing and data transfer service available at this point. Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect are open source. So Apache Kafka is open source solution and Kafka Connect, we already had a solution for this implemented. It is also based on open source technology. Kafka Connect solution was implemented for ReactFS to transfer data into ReactFS. We also have Confluent managed Kafka offering, and the traditional ActiveMQ, RabbitMQ messaging queue solutions are also available. Amazon Kinesis, Azure Event Hub, these are also solutions available. Also, finally, user can also go with Synchronous Web Services. Now, in our case, Synchronous Web Services could not be used as this would, as if in case certain node goes down, we will be losing the data. And Amazon Kinesis, Azure Event Hub cannot be used because our client was heavily invested in Google Cloud, and these are part of AWS and Azure offerings. Traditional ActiveMQ and RabbitMQ solutions, we never had experience with them at such a high scale, so we left them out. Confluent Kafka, Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect, and Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow. These are the three tech stacks which we considered for the streaming layer. And for REST API layer, we have considered the Eclipse Vertex. Eclipse Vertex is non-blocking asynchronous REST API service provided by Eclipse. It's open source and scales in an awesome manner. And furthermore, deploying it on Google Kubernetes engine helps with auto scaling in a very nice manner. It is responsible for publishing messages to both the tech stacks, that is the Google PubSub or Apache Kafka. And load testing at scale, we used Locust. Previously, we had also evaluated Apache Bench, JMeter, et cetera, but the distributed setup we couldn't find for them. Locust was very easily scalable, and deploying on Kubernetes reduced the cost also. Monitoring at scale for Google managed services, Google Stackdriver is a nice solution. For open source services, open source technologies, we use Grafana plus Prometheus for monitoring and Loki for logging. And once this all is done, then these are the results findings which we had. So firstly, we'll go with the Google PubSub, its throughput and concurrency. So if you see this graph, this is our Java SDK vertex publishing results to the Google PubSub. So around, if you can say that roughly 60,000 requests per second, consistently it is able to push. And payload size was 10 KB, individual payload size. Average concurrency was 60,000 requests per second. So roughly around 600 Mbps request throughput per second we were able to achieve with 18 cores. Now, this graph is from the Google blog. And if you see with the various technology, various language, various Go, Java, etc., we are able, they have shown like with 16 cores between 600 to 800 requests per second, they're able to push. So our results are almost very much similar to what Google is publishing on there this month. So their benchmarks helped us also to confirm our findings. Nextly, if you go with the Google Dataflow, that is the data transfer service. Here, if you see, this is the first graph on left. It is the load balancer graph, Google load balancer graph, where we can see that over 1 hour, slowly the incoming request from Locust is slowly being scaled. And here, if you see the Google data flow, it is also scaling in a predictable manner compared to the incoming throughput. Now, this setup was strictly without auto scaling was disabled and streaming engine was disabled, so that we can see how much was the CPU usage and RAM usage. Roughly, we at an average 70% CPU usage was used at this level. And average throughput was 600 Mbps and total cores used for this was 60. Excuse me. Next, this is about the Kafka cluster setup. So here, if you see on the left, here is the Google load balancer throughput again. So roughly around 60,000 requests per 65,000 requests per second were published, and overall average throughput that was published by Vertex to PubSub was 530 Mbps. Total cores used again were 18. So if you see, Eclipse Vertex is able to perform very nicely in writing to both Google PubSub and Apache Kafka. Now here, if you see on the right, here is the Apache Kafka graph screenshot from the Grafana. And total 10 nodes were used, and each node was roughly 4 core, 15 GB RAM and 1 TB SSD. Total 25 partitions were there, replication factor was 2. And if you see, the publishing rate was smooth and almost like 6 hours it was able to sustain the throughput. And in the next slide here, if you see, we have used Kafka Connect, and that is also able to sustain the throughput. And for Kafka Connect also was able to consume almost at like 530 Mbps. It was able to do with 25 cores. Hence, for Kafka cluster, if we can summarize, write throughput 13.25 Mbps per core we were able to achieve, and read throughput we were able to achieve in similar range. Nextly, once the throughput was clear for us, both Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect and Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow, they were able to achieve required throughput for us. Next, we evaluated for scalability. So here, if you see Google PubSub, so this is our graph on left. So here, if you see, like it within 1 minute, we were able to scale from 0 to 30,000 requests per second. And similar experiments, Spotify team also had run, and it was published on their blog. They were able to, within 5 minutes, they were able to reach 1 million requests per second. Now, this is not a strict number. We cannot say this. I'm sure it might be that the scalability will be much faster for Google PubSub. It also, because the scalability depends on the load testing tool also, but we could max scale at this level. So yeah, these are the numbers for at this point. And as a summary, Google PubSub scales seamlessly for our requirements. Nextly, Google Dataflow auto scaling. So we saw that it takes almost 7 to 10 minutes for Dataflow to auto scale. And initially we for example, if you see this graph, initially we allocated almost 20 nodes and it took 7 to 10 minutes for it to further add the nodes. Also it scales at 20% CPU utilization, and this was confirmed by their documentation. Unlike Google Kubernetes Engine, there is no way to fine tune this trigger for auto scaling. And because of this, it can be that the average CPU usage of the cluster might be very much less. That may lead to cost escalations. And for latency, both Google PubSub and Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect, they matched our requirements for latency. We were able to achieve desired latency of less than 4 minutes. 95% of messages published by REST layer were delivered to Google Cloud Storage in 1.5 minutes. All messages were delivered within 3 minutes with both Google plus PubSub plus Google Dataflow and Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect. Excuse me. For high availability and fault tolerance, both Google PubSub and Confluent Kafka are highly available. They have multi-region setup. So in case certain data center or availability zone is down, still the availability of Google PubSub or Confluent Kafka based setup should be available for users to publish messages to those REST APIs. Apache Kafka can be deployed in multi-region deployment using Mirror Maker, but that will require sufficient effort. And secondly, it will also require ample amount of maintenance and SRE costs. Delivery reliability for our system, like we discussed previously, as data warehouse is able to handle deduplication to certain extent, at least once payload delivery was required. In longevity tests, we noticed that both the Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow and Kafka plus Kafka Connect setups duplicates were less than 0.1%. Additionally, we ran throughput and concurrency benchmarks with 15% load so that we can compensate for unexpected spikes during the actual deployments. And this is the cost estimation for processing 100,000 requests per second for various stacks. On the left, we have Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow. On the right, we have Kafka cluster plus Kafka cluster and Kafka Connect costing. So Google PubSub costing is majorly based on how much data is published to Google PubSub. So for publishing 100,000 requests per second for entire month, roughly 1555 TB of data will be published. So based on that, for 1 TB PubSub charges $40 as per the documentation. So roughly it costs around $62,000 per month. And in Google Dataflow, we were able to achieve 5,000 requests per second with 4-core nodes. And so hence we required for 100,000 requests per second, almost like 20 nodes. And this was without streaming engine. Hence the costing with for 20 nodes comes down to 5148. And hence summing both of them, total PubSub plus Dataflow cost per month tentatively should be around $67,000. Kafka cluster plus Kafka costing. Kafka cluster, we project that for 10,000 requests per second, it should take around 15 nodes. And for each node, we have to include in the costing compute, RAM, and disk. So these we have taken. Disk size roughly 51 TB is required to store data for one day. And based on this, the disk cost is the maximum contributor at $9,000 per month. And compute engine cost is $1,456. In total, it is roughly around $10,000 per month. Kafka Connect costing. Kafka Connect was again hosted on Google Kubernetes Engine. And roughly Kafka Connect with also 4-core nodes, it was able to consume at 5,000 requests per second. So based on that, Kafka Connect costs around $1,941 per month. Overall, Kafka plus Kafka Connect cost per month for a single data center deployment is around $12,000. But for Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow, it comes down to $67,000. Now this solution is also multi-region setup. So again, that should be also appreciated while taking cost into picture. Nextly, here we have Confluent Kafka deployment costs. Similar to Google PubSub, Confluent Kafka cost is based on the amount of data that is published to Kafka, that has been consumed from Kafka, and how much data you retain. Based on this, if you retain for like one day of data, roughly this much GBs will be retained retained across month, and this much data will be published and consumed. And this is the pricing based on the documentation, and total Confluent Kafka costing based on this is roughly $578,000 per month. Similarly, transferring data from Confluent Kafka to GCS, again Kafka Connect costing is Kafka Connect will be required. Confluent Kafka has a enterprise solution for Google Cloud Storage Data Transfer Service. And we are assuming that its costing should be very similar to $1941. Overall, total Confluent Kafka plus Kafka Connect costs for Confluent Kafka Enterprise setup should be around $580K per month, based on 100K requests per month, per day. Sorry, per second. And apart from this, the infrastructure will also require a REST API layer, and we also have to take into consideration the Google Cloud storage costs. REST API layer cost for this one, like with four cores with primitive Vertex, we were able to process almost like 10,000 requests per second. So roughly we require, this will be the cost for it. We'll be requiring 10 nodes of four cores each. So roughly for $970 per month will come. And Google Cloud storage costs, again, we are retaining like, if we are retaining like, three days of data, then it will be roughly costing $5,300 per month. Lastly, this is the comparison of all the four solutions. So the option one is with Kafka on-demand independent machines, and Google and Kafka Connect and the REST API being hosted on the Google Kubernetes Engine and Google Cloud Storage. The option two is if in GKE, you can also host on preemptable machines. Preemptable machines are similar to spot machines in AWS. So the costing is 1/3 of on-demand regular machines. So as both Kafka Connect and Prebid REST API, that is the Vertex, both of them are stateless in nature. So they can be also hosted on preemptable machines with little if the solution is okay with the little loss in data over time. And lastly, option three is with PubSub and Dataflow, and option four is with Confluent Kafka setup. So cost per million requests for option one is $0.07, option two is $0.06, 0.28, and option four is $2.26. Now this solutioning is for 100,000 requests per second. This is a cost estimation, and load balancer cost will be extra apart from this. And also these numbers we have taken from these various sites, etc., almost 6 to 7 months back, and the figure and the Google and the cloud technologies are innovating at a very fast stage, hence the pricing also is varying a lot. So whenever you are using this as a reference, we'll request you please get the latest numbers and keep them into consideration for evaluating the costing for your systems. And this is also a cost estimate, and it will vary from customer to customer for Google Cloud also. Lastly, this is our conclusion. excuse me. For latency, load balancing, throughput, and message delivery reliability, both stacks, Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow, Apache Kafka plus Kafka Connect, perform very well to our requirements. For system availability and fault tolerance, Apache Kafka cluster was deployed in single data center is fault tolerant. But in case of Google PubSub, the topics are hosted in multiple regions, and an unavailability of single data center should have minimal impact on system availability. From scalability perspective, Google Dataflow auto scaling was not supporting fine tuning and scaling triggers. Because of this, we can see less efficient usage of the Dataflow cluster, leading to spikes in cost. Kafka Connect can be deployed on Kubernetes, and this scales seamlessly and help with cost reduction. Maintenance and SRE, Google PubSub and Google Dataflow are cloud managed services, and 24/7 support is provided by Google Teams. Apache Kafka and Kafka Connect are open source technologies and require a dedicated team for ensuring system uptime. Cost effectiveness, single data center deployment of Kafka cluster is within our project's budget of $30,000. Pure Google PubSub plus Google Dataflow based setup is beyond project's budget, and similar was Confluent Kafka Enterprise. It was beyond our budget. Lastly, based on our all these experiments, instead of going for a single Kafka or Google PubSub based solution, we went for a hybrid solution. So this is the architecture, the proposed architecture to the client for this. So here, if you see on the left, we have a primary pipeline, and on the right, we have a secondary pipeline. So generally, over the long time, 99% of the time when the messages are received by load balancer, they are published to the Vertex, And Vertex will see that Kafka cluster is in good health. It will publish the messages to Kafka. Later, Kafka Connect will consume the data from Kafka and publish the same to Google Cloud Storage. And in case Vertex detects that Kafka cluster is not available, let's say that Zookeeper is not responding or within time, or let's say resources have gone down or some deployment issues, automatically Vertex will switch to the Google Cloud PubSub and publish the messages there. Whenever this happens, probably a trigger or pager can be triggered, and Cloud Dataflow cluster can be spawned, and all the messages that are present in Google Cloud PubSub, Cloud Dataflow will transfer them to Cloud Storage. Similarly, once the Kafka Connect is Kafka cluster is available and Vertex detects that it is doing good, in that case, again, it will start transmitting the data to Kafka. And once we see that there are no more messages left in Cloud PubSub, Cloud Dataflow cluster can be turned on. And let's say that even if Vertex, even the Vertex also can be deployed in multi the region setup, so that if the region where this is hosted, it is not available, in that case, still the Kubernetes cluster will be able to, Vertex will be able to publish the messages to Cloud PubSub. And because of this, we almost get 99.99% of system availability for the REST API. Any questions at this point? If any questions, please write it into the chat so that we can start. Okay, as few of the people are still thinking about how to formulate the points, let me just get back. Nextly, I want to talk about the data warehouse which we have used. That is the NitroDB. It is Sigmoid's in-house product being deployed in almost like 10 customers. It is based on Apache Spark, and we have customized Apache Spark to great extent so that we are able to support features like materialized views, pagination, indexes, Bloom filters, etc. And because of this, the data warehouse is fully fledged. It is able to consume messages from Amazon S3, Azure, Google Cloud, Google BigQuery, and data warehouses like Google BigQuery, Snowflake, and Redshift. It can also consume messages from Amazon. It can also work with aggregated data or log level data. And also it can work with multiple data sets. And complex ETL pipelines are also supported so that the data can be processed and aggregated. And again, the support is available for Tableau, Power BI, Looker, MicroStrategy. And we also have our own custom dashboarding tool called SigView. It supports various dashboards, high-speed dashboards, and alerts, etc. So based on all this, NitroDB supports fast ingestion, very fast response. The dashboards can respond within like three seconds, and it is fully managed by Sigmoid team 24/7. We also have a dedicated data engineering team to provide solutions to various clients. We have very experienced specialists in data science, and we also provide DevOps activity and managed services also. And this was the tech stack for entire production deployment for various monitoring, deployment, and 24/7 management. Thank you so much.